Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Murder on St. Nicholas Avenue, A Gaslight Mystery by Victoria Thompson. Narrated by Suzanne Toren. Chapter 1. Maeve hurried to answer the door. Whoever was out there was getting impatient. Ringing the bell hadn't been good enough. Now they were knocking, too. Little Catherine had to practically run to keep up, but she wasn't about to be left behind by her nursemaid.
"Is it a baby?" Catherine asked,
easily remembering how her mother would be summoned at all hours to deliveries when she was a midwife, since those calls had stopped only a few short months ago. "I hope not," Maeve replied. "Your mama doesn't deliver babies anymore, and besides, she's too far away to help even if she did." Maeve pulled open the door and found a middle-aged woman standing on the doorstep. Her hat was obviously the one she saved for best, although her coat had seen better days. Maeve instantly classified her as one of the people who had started coming to the Malloy house looking for a handout as soon as they discovered her employer, Frank Malloy, had become a millionaire. "Is this where the Malloys live?" the woman asked, looking up doubtfully at the imposing facade. Malloy and his new bride had decided to wait until they returned from their honeymoon to hire servants, but Maeve was starting to think that had been a terrible mistake. Nothing like a snooty butler to send people on their way.
"Yes, it is, but I'm a friend of Mrs. Malloy. Mrs. Alma Malloy, that is, not the new Mrs. She's not, oh, I know she's not home now," the woman said, twisting her hands anxiously. "She's with the boy at his school, isn't she? I wouldn't know that if I wasn't really her friend, now would I? But it's not her I was wanting to see, is it? No, it's himself, Mr. Malloy. Francis. I've known him from a boy, I have, and I..." To Maeve's dismay, the woman burst into tears.
Maeve glanced up and down the street, checking to see if the woman had brought someone with her. She saw no one else lurking about. Briefly, she debated inviting the woman inside. She and Catherine were there alone, but the woman didn't look dangerous. Besides, how could she shut the door and leave someone sobbing on the stoop?
"Come in, please," Maeve said, taking the woman's arm and drawing her inside. "Why is the lady crying?" Catherine asked.
The woman stopped dead at the sound of the child's voice and made a visible effort to recover her composure.
"And who's this now?" she asked. "This is Mrs. Brandt's, Mrs. Malloy's daughter. The new Mrs. Malloy, that is."
"Francis's new bride," she said, nodding. "A sweet little thing she is, too."
"Mr. Malloy is my papa now," Catherine said.
"Of course he is," she said with a watery smile. "I don't suppose I could speak with Francis, could I? It's very important, you see, a matter of life and death."
It was always a matter of life and death when people wanted a handout, Maeve thought. But she said,
"I'm sorry to say that he's not here, but I'll be happy to tell him you called."
"I can wait for him. I have to see him right away, you know."
"You'll have a very long wait, I'm afraid. He's still on his honeymoon, and we don't expect them back for several weeks yet."
"Several weeks?" she repeated, her eyes flooding with tears again. "But I can't. I have to see him. It's my daughter, you see. They've put her in jail. And they say she's done murder, but she never did. She's a good girl, my Una. She would never do what they said. But they're going to hang her unless Francis helps her."
Oh, dear. This wasn't at all what Maeve had been expecting, and not something Catherine needed to hear about either. She glanced down to see the child's eyes had widened in alarm.
"Mrs. I'm sorry I didn't get your name."
"Mrs. O'Neill, lass. I'm so sorry to bother you, but..."
"Not at all. Why don't we go into the kitchen, Mrs. O'Neill, and I'll make a nice cup of tea, and you can tell me all about your daughter."
"I don't want to be any trouble now, miss."
"It's no trouble. Mrs. Malloy would never forgive me if I turned away an old friend in need," Maeve lied.
Mrs. Malloy generally thought old friends in need were a lot of trouble. Maeve would have to distract Catherine somehow first, of course, but before she could come up with a plan, someone else rang their doorbell. Wonderful. Another visitor. With an apologetic smile, she opened the front door again to find their neighbor, Mrs. Ellsworth, smiling broadly and carrying a planter filled with sprigs of holly and trailing ivy.
Maeve, dear, I've got this little planting for you, and— Oh, my, I didn't know you had company, she said, doing a much better job of lying than even Maeve herself could do, because, of course, she'd known very well that Maeve had company.
Mrs. Ellsworth didn't consider it lying at all, though. People said things that weren't true all the time in polite society. It was just good manners, according to Mrs. Ellsworth. Mrs. Ellsworth breezed right in without being invited, and Maeve did not object because they both knew she'd come to see if Maeve needed rescuing from an importunate beggar from the Malloys' old neighborhood. Nothing much happened on Bank Street that Mrs. Ellsworth didn't notice. She would have spotted the strange woman at the Malloys' door in a heartbeat. Maeve introduced the two women.
"Are you quite well, Mrs. O'Neill?"
Mrs. Ellsworth inquired, seeing the woman's red-rimmed eyes.
"Mrs. O'Neill has had some trouble, and she came to ask Mr. Malloy for help. It's detective business," she added,
so Mrs. Ellsworth would understand that she didn't need assistance in running Mrs. O'Neill off. Frank Malloy had been a police detective until he came into money, and now he sometimes helped people in trouble.
"I was just wondering if Catherine could visit with you for an hour or so while Mrs. O'Neill and I talk, at least until Brian and Mrs. Malloy get home from school."
"Of course, dear. You know little Catherine is always welcome. I'm just getting ready to make some pies for supper, and I know how she loves to make the lattice crusts. Would you like to help me with that?" she asked the child.
Plainly, Catherine wanted to stay and find out why this strange lady had been crying, but she was too well trained to refuse the invitation.
"Yes, ma'am, I would."
"That's wonderful," Mrs. Ellsworth said, then seemed to remember the planter she still held. "And this is for your household, Maeve, for Christmas good fortune. The holly brings good luck to men, and the ivy brings good luck to us females. We must always have them both together. That's only fair, don't you think? And let me know immediately if the ivy starts to wither. That's a very bad sign. And never burn the holly when it's still green. That's very bad luck."
Nearly overwhelmed by the detailed instructions while her mind was still on Mrs. O'Neill's problems, Maeve thanked her and took the planter and set it on a table in the hallway. A few moments later, after Catherine had been bundled into her hat and coat, she and Mrs. Ellsworth headed out across the street to Mrs. Ellsworth's house.
"This house is very nice,"
Mrs. O'Neill said, looking around in awe at the massive staircase and the chandelier hanging from the ceiling 20 feet above.
"Thank you," Maeve said. "I should probably take you into the parlor."
"Oh, no, the kitchen is fine for the likes of me, lass."
She followed as Maeve led the way to the back of the house.
"Alma must be very comfortable here."
"She seems to be,"
Maeve said, biting back a smile. Mrs. Malloy wasn't the kind of person to let on if she was comfortable or not. A few minutes later, Maeve had gotten Mrs. O'Neill to take off her coat and have a seat at the kitchen table, while Maeve set water to boil on the newly installed gas stove. It was one of only a few in the entire city, they'd been told. While she waited for the water, she cut a few slices of the pound cake left over from yesterday and arranged them on a plate. By the time the tea was steeping and the cake had been served, over Mrs. O'Neill's polite objections, her guest had calmed down quite a bit.
"I'm sorry Mr. Malloy isn't here," Maeve began, "but I would be glad to hear your story and help you figure out what to do."
She smiled sadly.
"Oh, lass, there's nothing you can do, I'm sure."
Maeve smiled.
"Don't judge me by my looks, Mrs. O'Neill. I've helped Mr. Malloy solve many a case."
It was only a slight exaggeration. Mrs. O'Neill frowned.
Oh, surely not.
I've also done work for the Pinkerton Detective Agency, so even if I can't help you, I'll know someone who can. Now tell me, why on earth would someone accuse your daughter of committing murder?
Her eyes filled with tears again, but she resolutely blinked them back.
I can't hardly believe it myself, but I saw her in the jail with my own eyes, just sitting there staring at the wall, all covered with blood she was. She wouldn't say a word to me, not a single word. They said she hasn't said anything at all since it happened.
Since what happened?
Mrs. O'Neill drew a deep breath and let it out on a shaky sigh.
It's a long story.
I'm not going anywhere.
Maeve picked up the teapot and poured them each another cup.
Well, it all started. Oh, dear, was it only 5 months ago? Yes, just that. My Una, she's a pretty girl. I'm not bragging, everyone says so. And she's a good girl, too, not vain like a lot of pretty girls are.
I'm sure, Maeve said, doubting that, but nodding her encouragement.
She got a job at a factory about a year ago, sewing ladies' clothes. She'd give me her wages every week. I told you she's a good girl.
Maeve nodded again.
Then, one day, she came home that excited. A gentleman had seen her and offered her a job in his cigar shop.
Seen her where?
Coming out of the factory. He was watching all the girls and he picked her out special because she's so pretty.
This sounded suspicious to Maeve. Men were always trying to take advantage of young women in the city.
Did he really have a cigar shop?
Oh, yes. I can see what you're thinking, but I wouldn't let her get tricked into something bad. I went with her to see his shop. He was such a nice man. He liked to have a pretty girl to work behind the counter, he told us. It attracts customers. They come in to flirt with the girl and buy a cigar or two while they're there.
So long as cigars are all he's selling, Maeve thought.
He'd just lost his counter girl because she'd gotten married. That happened to all the girls who'd worked there, he said. One of the customers would fall in love and off she'd go. So Una not only got a good job that paid more than she'd been getting at the factory, she also got a chance to meet a nice young man with prospects.
And did she meet someone?
Oh, yes. She wasn't there long before Mr. Pollock noticed her. He'd come in nearly every day, she said. Always polite, you understand. Mr. Winter didn't allow his girls to be treated rude. He told me that right off, or I never would have let her go there. And Mr. Pollock, he fell in love with my Una.
Which was, of course, what all men say when they want to have their way with a girl. Maeve's grandfather had told her that a million times when she was growing up, and in her limited experience, she'd found it to be quite true.
Did Mr. Pollock want to marry Una?
He did. At first she thought he was teasing. A lot of men teased her about getting married, but he was serious. He couldn't convince her at first, but then he asked if he could see her home one evening to meet me. And when he did, he asked if he could marry my girl.
This sounded like a fairy tale, but unlike fairy tales, it probably didn't end happily. Something had obviously gone terribly wrong at some point, or Mrs. O'Neill wouldn't need help from Frank Malloy.
Did they get married?
Oh, yes. And it wasn't one of those sham marriages either. I was there. I saw it happen. The priest said the words over them all right and proper. But this was only after I went to see his house. He has a beautiful house up in Harlem, on St. Nicholas Avenue. It's where all the rich people are moving. That's what he told us. He has a woman to cook for him and two more to clean and a boy to do the heavy work. And Mr. Pollock, he adored my Una. My girl was going to have the life I always hoped she would. It was like a miracle.
But she didn't.
Oh, she did. Mr. Pollock, he bought her new clothes, and she lived in his beautiful house, and they were so happy. She was so happy. I know they were. He adored her.
She went still, staring off at something only she could see. Maeve waited, not wanting to rush her, not really wanting to know at all, in fact.
"They came to me today. The police. Our roundsman, I should say. He knows me, you see. His wife and I go to church together. He told me Una was in the jail and I should go down right away. He told me..."
Her voice broke and she covered her face with both hands. Maeve waited, her stomach knotted, her fists clenched tightly on the tabletop. Finally, Mrs. O'Neill lowered her hands. Her eyes were awful, full of despair.
"They said she'd killed him. Killed Mr. Pollock. But how could that be? She loved him. He was her husband."
Maeve knew lots of wives would happily murder their husbands, and a few who actually had. But she didn't think that information would comfort Mrs. O'Neill.
"What did Una say when you saw her in the jail?"
"Nothing. I told you she wouldn't say a word. They told me she hadn't said anything at all since they found her."
"Where did they find her?"
"At the house, Mr. Pollock's house. She was sitting on the floor in the parlor, holding his head in her lap."
"Who found her?"
"The maid, I think it was. He was dead, they told me, and she was just sitting there with his bloody head in her lap, stroking his hair."
"How did he die?"
"Someone hit him on the head, they said. Crushed his skull, they told me. Una must have found him, or maybe she even saw it happen. She was in shock, I'm sure. That's why she couldn't tell them what really happened. So they put her in jail. And now they're going to hang her."
Maeve knew that New York no longer hanged murderers. They used the very modern electric chair instead. But Mrs. O'Neill wouldn't want to know that either.
"So, you see, Miss... Oh, dear, I never even asked your name."
"I'm sorry, I should have told you. Maeve Smith. I'm the nursemaid for Mrs. Brandt's, that is, Mrs. Frank Malloy's daughter."
"A nursemaid? Who works with the Pinkertons?" she asked with a frown.
"No one notices a nursemaid. You'd be amazed at what I can find out."
Mrs. O'Neill smiled sadly.
"I'm sure, my girl, but I don't think there's anything a nursemaid can do for my Una."
"You're right. At least at the moment, the first thing you need to do is hire an attorney."
"And how would I do that, miss? And what would I pay him with?"
This was a problem, of course.
"Do you have any money at all?"
"I have a little put by, but not much."
"Would your daughter have any? Maybe she tucked away some housekeeping money or something?"
"I don't know."
"Did she ever say anything about it? Her husband must have given her money for shopping and things."
Well, that is...
"What?"
Maeve prodded when Mrs. O'Neill hesitated.
"I didn't... After they got married, Mr. Pollock, he didn't want me coming around anymore."
She dropped her gaze, unable to look Maeve in the eye.
"I haven't seen Una in, well, since the day she got married."
That didn't sound like a man who adored his wife. Why would he have forbidden his mother-in-law from visiting his wife if he really cared about her? She couldn't think of any good reason, but she didn't want to go into that with Mrs. O'Neill just now. First things first.
"Una should be able to spend her husband's money. She probably knows where he keeps it, at least. And if he has any in the house, we'll find it. I can help you with that."
"Wouldn't that be stealing?"
"Of course it would, but Maeve said, the money belongs to your daughter now that her husband is dead. You can use it to pay a lawyer."
"What good will a lawyer do?"
Maeve felt a stab of envy for someone who had never needed the services of an attorney.
"He can figure out how to get Una out of jail, for one thing."
"Really?"
Maeve decided not to explain the concept of bail just yet.
"Yes, I'll write down the name and address of an attorney I know. He can help you. Tomorrow you can visit Una and find out if she knows where her husband kept his money. In the meantime, I'm going to find out what the police know and why they think Una killed her husband.
The police? How will you find out anything from them?
Maeve smiled. I'm just going to ask. Officer Gino Donatelli found himself whistling as he strolled down Bank Street and climbed the front steps to the Malloy house. He probably shouldn't feel so happy about being summoned, especially when he knew Malloy was still on his honeymoon, so this couldn't possibly be an opportunity for him to work on a case, but he was whistling just the same. He rang the bell and waited. Then the door opened and Maeve Smith was there, and he couldn't hold back his smile.
Miss Smith, he tipped his hat.
Officer Donatelli, she replied. She wasn't smiling, but she usually made a point of not smiling at him. She stepped aside and motioned him in. Before either of them could say anything else, two small bodies launched themselves at him, and he had to greet the children of the house. Catherine and Brian were both talking at once. Catherine used her voice, and Brian used his hands, signing the way they had taught him at the deaf school he attended.
What's he saying?
Gino asked Maeve, but Catherine answered.
He's telling you we got a letter from Mama and Papa yesterday. They're in France.
Are they now? And what are they doing in France?
Gino asked.
Honeymooning,
Catherine informed him.
That sounds like fun, Gino said, grinning at Maeve, but she ignored him.
Officer Donatelli and I need to talk, she said, signing for Brian's benefit. The children tried to argue, but by then Mrs. Malloy had made her much more dignified way from the kitchen. Frank's mother was a formidable woman, even though she wasn't quite 5 feet tall, and she tolerated no nonsense.
Good evening, Officer Donatelli, she said. Have you had your supper?
Yes, ma'am, I have, thank you.
Maeve, take him to the kitchen and give him a slice of that pie we had, she said.
I help make it, Catherine said.
Then I'm sure it's delicious.
Come along, children, Mrs. Malloy said, taking them each by the hand.
I'll see you later, after Miss Smith and I have finished talking, he promised them.
Maeve led him down the hall without speaking. He hung his hat on the hall tree and followed her, silently admiring the shape of her as they went. Have a seat, she said, pulling a half-eaten apple pie with a lattice crust out of the pie safe and proceeding to cut him a generous slice.
This is very nice, he said when she set it in front of him, but I have to admit I expected at least a kiss when I got here.
That finally got a reaction out of her. She reared back.
Why would you expect a kiss?
Because the message you left for me at police headquarters made everybody think you were my sweetheart.
Oh, I never said any such thing.
Her cheeks had turned a becoming shade of pink, just as he'd expected.
I took a lot of ribbing about it, too, he said, as if he didn't notice.
He'd also heard some speculation that she was going to tell him he was about to become a father, because why else would a girl go to the trouble of leaving an urgent telephone message for him at headquarters? He decided not to mention that, though. Knowing Maeve, she'd hit him with the pie pan.
It couldn't have been that bad. I see you managed to survive, she said with a smirk.
Just barely. So what was so important that you had to see me tonight?
She put some coffee on to boil, and while he ate his pie, she told him about the woman from Malloy's old neighborhood who had come looking for help for her daughter.
I heard about it today, the murder. Everybody was talking down at headquarters, he said.
What did you hear?
Just that some woman bashed her husband's head in. It was way up in Harlem, so nobody from headquarters was involved.
Do you think you could get assigned to investigate?
Gino frowned.
I'm not a detective, Maeve.
Besides, they think the wife did it, so the police aren't investigating anything.
But if she wants to hire a private investigator, he added with a hopeful grin.
She doesn't have any money. She wasn't even sure she could hire a lawyer for her daughter.
Gino tried not to feel too disappointed. When he'd returned from fighting the war in Cuba last summer, he'd helped Malloy on a case. This wasn't unusual. He'd helped Malloy on several cases, but that was when they'd both worked for the New York City Police Department. When Malloy had come into some money recently, he'd lost his police detective's job.
so last summer they'd both worked on the case as private investigators. Then Malloy left on his honeymoon to Europe, and as Malloy had advised him to do, Gino had returned to his old job with the police, even though he wasn't particularly happy to be back on the force.
Then there's not much I can do except ask around to see what I can find out.
Maeve sighed. I wish the Malloys were back.
So do I. Mr. Malloy would help, I know.
Maybe we can help at least a little. Excitement stirred at the thought of a real case, but he tamped it down.
I'll do what I can, but it'll have to be when I'm off duty.
That's fine.
Maeve?
Yes?
What if you find out this Una really did kill her husband?
Then I'm sure she had a really good reason. Maybe she even did it in self-defense. A woman doesn't just bash a man's head in for nothing.
She was right, of course. A man might do something violent just because he was drunk, but women, respectable women anyway, usually got violent only as a last resort. What are you going to do?
Tomorrow, Mrs. O'Neill will visit her daughter in jail to find out if she's got any money hidden away somewhere. Then I'm meeting her at her daughter's house. We're going to tell the servants that Una needs some clothes and things at the jail. That'll give us an excuse to go in the house and look around to see if we can find any money that Mrs. O'Neill can use to hire an attorney to help Una.
Don't people like that keep their money in banks?
Sure, but they need cash to pay their servants and to buy things with. Mr. Malloy left us a lot of money for expenses while they're gone. We keep it in a safe. I figure Pollock kept at least a little money in his house, too.
What if Pollock's money is in a safe?
Maeve shrugged. I'm hoping he kept his money in a drawer or under the mattress.
Gino hoped she was right. What if the servants won't let you in?
What do you mean?
Servants are trained to keep people out. They won't know you at all. And if what you say about Mrs. O'Neill never being allowed to visit her daughter is true, they won't know her either. Who's to say you're not two strangers looking to rob the place?
Maeve frowned. You're right. Mrs. Brandt would know how to get them to let her in.
Mrs. Malloy, you mean, Gino said with a grin. And her mother would know even better.
Her mother? You mean Mrs. Decker?
Maeve said, perking right up again. Can you imagine any maid refusing to let her in?
The Deckers were descended from the original Knickerbocker families who had founded New York City. They'd had money and servants for generations. Of course! She'd be happy to help! The sparkle in Maeve's eyes told him she knew exactly how happy Mrs. Decker would be, too. Rich ladies seldom got to do anything exciting.
Just make sure Mr. Decker doesn't find out.
Poor Mrs. O'Neill nearly fainted when Maeve and Mrs. Decker emerged from the Decker's carriage in front of Pollock's house the next day. Miss Smith, is that you? She asked a little breathlessly, warily eyeing Maeve's imposing companion. Yes, it is, and let me introduce Mrs. Felix Decker. She's Mr. Malloy's mother-in-law, and she has come to help us.
Mrs. O'Neill managed to mumble something appropriate in response to the introduction, although Maeve could see she was completely in awe of the finely dressed matron. Mrs. Decker's fur-trimmed coat and matching muff probably cost more than a cigar shop clerk earned in a year.
I'm so pleased to meet you, Mrs. O'Neill, Mrs. Decker said as warmly as if she were meeting one of the Vanderbilts. I was sorry to hear of your daughter's misfortune. I hope Maeve and I can be of some assistance to you. When I told Mrs. Decker what happened, she insisted on coming with me, Maeve explained. That's very kind, I'm sure, Mrs. O'Neill said faintly as Mrs. Decker swept past her. Is this the house? She asked, indicating the gray stone turreted row house behind Mrs. O'Neill. Yes, but... Mrs. Decker climbed the long flight of steps that led to the front door, located on the second floor. Maeve indicated Mrs. O'Neill should follow, which she did with obvious reluctance. Maeve brought up the rear after the driver, John, handed her the carpet bag Mrs. Decker had thought to bring along.
I'm not sure we should be doing this,
Mrs. O'Neill whispered to Maeve. You have every right to be in your daughter's house, Maeve lied. Mrs. Decker used the brass knocker with what Maeve realized was authority. She would have to remember exactly how she did that. After what seemed like a long time, the door opened just a bit, and a very uncertain face peered out. "Good morning," Mrs. Decker said. "Mrs. Pollock's mother is here to gather some things for her. If you would be so kind..." Maeve couldn't tell if Mrs. Decker actually pushed on the door or not, but the maid seemed to stumble a bit as she jumped out of the way when Mrs. Decker swept inside.
"There's nobody at home," the maid tried.
"Of course not," Mrs. Decker said. She was in the foyer now. Maeve gave Mrs. O'Neill a small nudge of encouragement to herd her into the house, too. "Mr. Pollock is unfortunately deceased, and Mrs. Pollock is being detained by the police. That's why we are here. Mrs. Pollock needs a change of clothing and some toiletries. Would you please take her mother, Mrs. O'Neill, up to her bedroom so she can pack them?" Maeve didn't know who looked more astonished, the maid or Mrs. O'Neill. Mrs. Decker gave the young woman a few moments to react, and when she just stood there gaping, Mrs. Decker said, "Is it this way?" and started for the staircase at the end of the foyer. The girl scrambled to catch up, and Maeve gave Mrs. O'Neill another nudge. With a dismayed glance back at Maeve, she obediently followed the other two up the stairs. As she and Mrs. Decker had previously decided, Maeve remained downstairs, prepared to become inconspicuous until she was certain she was unobserved. This required a wait of only a few minutes, during which no other servant came to investigate, and the maid who had gone upstairs with the others did not reappear. Mrs. Decker would be keeping her busy, as they'd planned. When she was satisfied no one would notice, Maeve strolled down the hallway and glanced into each of the rooms. A small parlor to the right was the scene of the murder, according to what Mrs. O'Neill had told her. The room looked remarkably undisturbed, except that the carpet had been rolled up and lay like a low barrier in front of the doorway. Maeve imagined it was bloodstained, and the servants hadn't wanted to look at it. A long dining room lay to the left. Except for the rolled carpet, both rooms were well furnished, and everything in them was obviously brand new, if not of the very best quality. Beyond the parlor, behind a closed door, was what must have been Mr. Pollock's office or study. Judging from the lingering scent of tobacco smoke, no ladies would have felt welcome here. With another glance up and down the hallway to make sure no one was watching, Maeve stepped inside and closed the door behind her. Only then did she realize she still held the carpet bag. Muttering an imprecation at her carelessness, she set it down and hoped her companions didn't send the maid back down for it before she'd finished exploring this room. A walnut desk sat against one wall. Pollock was either very neat, or he didn't really do any work at this desk. The top was bare except for an inkwell and a few knick-knacks, and it had been polished to a shine. She checked the drawers but found nothing of interest there either. If Pollock kept money in the house, he probably had a more secure location than an unlocked desk. Two ugly landscape paintings hung on the walls, but neither concealed a wall safe. Pollock had no bookshelves to conceal hidden passages, the way they did in novels, and the only other furnishings in the room were two comfortable-looking leather armchairs and the table between them. Maeve sat down in one of the chairs and looked around the room again, wondering what she'd missed. That's when she noticed the table between the two chairs was rather oddly sized. The cube-shaped object seemed a bit too short for the job, and beneath a collection of singularly ugly knick-knacks was completely covered with what looked like a large silk scarf. The only reason you hid something with a scarf was because you didn't want anyone to see how old and battered it was, but everything else in this house was bright and shiny and new. Maeve lifted the scarf and found a squat and ugly but very sturdy-looking safe. Maeve sighed. Gino had been right about Pollock having a safe. He'd been concerned she wouldn't be able to open it, of course, and that was a legitimate concern. He probably couldn't imagine someone like herself being able to crack a safe either. That would, of course, be a valuable skill to have, especially at this particular moment. Her grandfather had taught her many things, but not that, unfortunately. He had, however, taught her another skill that might serve her even better. This time, when she searched Pollock's desk, she checked his nearly blank appointment diary more carefully.
and found the series of numbers he'd written at the bottom of the very last page in pencil. As she had hoped, they opened the safe on the second try. Pollock had been clever enough to list the numbers backward in case someone found them and guessed what they were. The safe opened with a satisfying click when she lifted the lever. She'd hoped to find a few $100 inside that Mrs. O'Neill could use for a lawyer, but what she did find sent her rearing back with a most unladylike yelp. Chapter 2. Police headquarters was unusually quiet when Gino arrived that morning. Of course, he was early for his shift because he wanted to see what he could find out about the Pollock murder, and early morning was that calm period of the day when the drunks from the night before were safely locked up and sleeping it off, and the evildoers of the daylight hours hadn't gotten started yet. The desk sergeant gave him a knowing grin, obviously remembering the to-do about Maeve's phone message the day before.
So, when's the wedding?
Nothing so drastic, Gino said, grinning back. She just missed me.
Is she that girl that works for Mrs. Brandt?
Everyone at headquarters knew Mrs. Brandt. She's Mrs. Malloy now, Gino reminded him, and yes, Miss Smith works for her.
Yes, Mrs. Malloy, the sergeant mused. That lucky bastard Malloy.
Gino wasn't sure if the sergeant thought Malloy was lucky because of his sudden wealth or his marriage to Mrs. Brandt, but he said,
I don't know about luck. After what happened to that Pollock fellow yesterday, marriage isn't looking too good to me.
From his high desk, the sergeant nodded at Gino.
You're right, poor fellow. Although who's to say he didn't deserve it, eh?
Yeah, a woman doesn't usually bash her husband on the head for no reason.
Did you hear anything about him?
The sergeant shrugged.
Nothing special, but he's a bouncer. All them fellas is shady, you ask me.
So, he had money, did he? Bouncer was a derogatory term for the newly rich who hadn't yet earned a place in society.
He lived in one of them new houses up in Harlem. They don't come cheap, although why anybody'd want to live way out in the country like that, I don't know.
It's pretty far, but it's not farmland anymore.
I guess not if bouncers are building houses there, the sergeant agreed.
Did you hear what Pollock did for a living? The sergeant frowned down at Gino.
You're awful interested in this fella.
Gino tried a shrug.
Just curious, I guess.
But the old sergeant wasn't fooled.
You ain't a detective, boy. Don't forget that. Nobody'll thank you for interfering in what ain't your business, and Malloy ain't here no more to cover for you.
That's good advice, Gino said, giving the old sergeant a mock salute. He was walking away, already trying to figure out how to be more subtle in his inquiries the next time, when the sergeant called,
But if you want to find out more about Pollock, ask Brogan. His cousin walks the beat up there, and he was the first one in the house.
Brogan, huh? I think he might still be mad at me about that case with the missing women. The sergeant gave a bark of laughter.
Oh, yeah, that was clever. But it's Malloy he's mad at. Besides, he's an Irishman. If you'll listen to him, he'll talk to you, mad or not.
Thanks, Sarge. Gino was whistling as he went to report for duty. Brogan wouldn't be in this early, but he'd be able to catch him later at his favorite bar. Maeve was sitting on the bench in the foyer just where they'd left her and looking completely innocent when Mrs. O'Neill and Mrs. Decker came back downstairs. The maid trailed behind them carrying a cheap suitcase that they'd apparently found upstairs. Thank heaven they hadn't needed the carpet bag which sat at her feet.
I hope you weren't bored waiting for us, Mrs. Decker said with a questioning look in her eye.
Oh, no, not at all. Did you get everything you needed for Mrs. Pollock?
Yes, and we also decided that we'll have my maid come back tomorrow and pack up all of Mrs. Pollock's things and take them to her mother's house. Under the circumstances, Mrs. Pollock will want to close up the house, I'm sure.
She didn't have to mention that with Pollock dead and Una in jail, there'd be no one to pay the servants and the other expenses of running a household.
Oh, you might want to wait a week or two before doing that, Maeve said. Mrs. Pollock will probably be released and she'll want to come home.
She'll want to come home to me, I'm sure, her mother said. She won't want to come back here after what happened.
But what'll become of us? The maid asked. There's nobody to write us a reference. Maeve had learned a lot about servants from Mrs. Decker, and she knew they changed employers frequently. The Pollock's servants wouldn't have been with them long, so they'd certainly feel no loyalty to Una.
I'll write all of you a reference if it comes to that, Mrs. Decker said, but don't go running off just yet. We'll see you're taken care of, and let me know if you need anything.
She gave the girl her calling card. Are we ready to go? Maeve said they were, so they filed out to the sidewalk where the Decker carriage still waited at the curb. The driver hurried to assist the ladies inside, taking the carpet bag from Maeve and setting it by her feet at her instruction. He strapped the other suitcase to the back and then scrambled up to his perch after receiving instructions to deliver Mrs. O'Neill to the city jail first. As soon as they were safely away from the house, Mrs. Decker said,
I assume your search was successful, Maeve.
Yes, it was, she said, reaching into her pocket and pulling out a wad of bills.
Mrs. O'Neill, this should be enough to hire the attorney whose name I gave you, and also to pay your daughter's bail, if he can arrange it.
Mrs. O'Neill stared at the money as if afraid it would bite her.
How much is there?
$500.
Mrs. O'Neill made a strangled sound. She'd certainly never seen so much money all at once, which would be more than a year's salary for an average person.
But I can't.
Of course you can, Maeve said. It's your daughter's money, after all. You should use it to help her.
What should I do with it?
Put it in your purse, Mrs. Decker suggested, but Mrs. O'Neill's horrified reaction clearly showed how dangerous she considered that idea.
Put a couple hundred in your purse to pay the attorney, Maeve said.
He'll want that much, she squeaked.
No, but you want him to see you've got more than what he asks for, so he'll be willing to take the case. You can put the rest of it down in your corset, so you won't have to worry about losing it. I'll show you.
By the time Maeve had helped her hide the rest of the money, Mrs. O'Neill looked a little less terrified.
What a good idea, Mrs. Decker said in wonder, having watched the whole thing with admiration. Where did you learn that?
Maeve didn't even consider answering truthfully.
I thought of it just now. It's clever, isn't it?
She turned back to Mrs. O'Neill.
The attorney's office is across the street from the jail, so go straight there after you take Una her things.
She still wouldn't talk to me this morning. I tried everything I knew, but she wouldn't speak. I think whoever killed Mr. Pollock may have injured her, too. But how would we know when she won't say anything?
Maeve had no reply for that, but Mrs. Decker said,
Maybe she'll speak with her attorney. Sometimes it's easier to talk to a stranger about something so serious.
Mrs. O'Neill looked doubtful, but she wasn't going to disagree with someone like Mrs. Decker. They rode the rest of the way in uneasy silence, in spite of Mrs. Decker's efforts to make small talk. When they'd dropped Mrs. O'Neill at the jail, Mrs. Decker turned to Maeve expectantly.
All right, you obviously found some money, but what else did you find?
What makes you think I found anything else? Maeve asked with a grin. Mrs. Decker pointed at the carpet bag sitting on the floor of the carriage.
That bag is full of something, and you wanted to keep it close. I was so glad you didn't need it for Una's clothes.
Maeve leaned over and opened it to reveal the contents. Mrs. Decker clapped a hand to her heart.
Good heavens! How much is there?
Maeve glanced at the stacks of cash.
I didn't take the time to count it, but it's thousands of dollars.
That's why you said we didn't need to close up the house.
Mrs. O'Neill thought Pollock was rich, but I'm not sure I really believed it before.
I don't believe it now. Mrs. Decker looked meaningfully at the carpet bag.
What do you mean? I mean, Pollock had a lot of money, but rich people keep their money in banks.
Maybe Pollock didn't trust banks.
I guess that's possible, but thieves don't trust banks either.
You think Pollock was a thief?
I have no idea, but he was a young man, from what Mrs. O'Neill told me, and she didn't seem to know exactly what he did for a living, and he's got thousands of dollars in a safe in his house. And
she rummaged in the carpet bag and pulled out a book.
I also found this.
What is it?
It's a ledger of some kind.
Maeve opened it and showed her.
See? There's names and amounts of money.
What does it mean?
I'm guessing it means these people gave him money and he's keeping track of it in this ledger.
Why would they have given him money? Maeve managed not to sigh. Mrs. Decker was hopelessly naive, and Maeve didn't want her to know how much she knew about cheating people.
Probably some business thing, but we don't know enough right now to even make a guess.
Maybe Mr. Decker could figure it out if he saw the ledger.
Mr. Decker?
Maeve echoed in alarm. The last thing she wanted was to face him if he found out she'd involved his wife in all this.
He's really not as terrifying as you seem to think, my dear, Mrs. Decker assured her. We can't let him know that I helped you today, of course. You know how he worries about me. But you can just bring the ledger over to our house this evening and ask him for his advice. You can tell him everything that's happened, except that I went with you to the Pollock house.
Maeve had to agree that this sounded like a good plan.
Should I bring the money, too?
Heavens, no. Doesn't Mr. Malloy have a safe?
Yes, he does.
I thought Sarah told me he did. Do you know the combination?
Of course. Mr. Malloy left money for us to spend while they're on their honeymoon.
Then put this money in the safe, too. Count it first, though. Mr. Decker will want to know how much you found. Was there anything else in the safe?
No, just the ledger and the money. I searched Pollock's desk, but I didn't find anything important in it except the combination to the safe. How odd that he would keep it so close. Lots of people write down the combination and keep it in a safe place in case they forget it.
It doesn't sound like his desk was a very safe place if you found it so easily.
Lots of people aren't very smart.
So it seems, Mrs. Decker agreed with a grin. Maeve was glad Mrs. Decker didn't think to ask her how she knew all this. When they arrived at the Malloy house, Mrs. Decker came in for a short visit with Catherine, who had been visiting Mrs. Ellsworth again for a few hours while Maeve did her detective work. She couldn't stay long, though, because she had to be home when Mr. Decker arrived. She didn't want to have to lie about where she'd been this afternoon. Maeve and Catherine started supper, and when Mrs. Malloy brought Brian home from school, they all ate together. Mrs. Decker had warned her that they ate supper late, so she shouldn't come until around 8 o'clock, which left a long time for Maeve to wait. Luckily, Gino Donatelli arrived shortly after they'd finished eating. He also had to spend a little time with the children before Maeve could steal him away. Luckily, Mrs. Malloy was there to get them ready for bed, while Maeve took him to the kitchen for a piece of cake. "Did you have any luck at Pollock's house today?" he asked as she sliced the cake.
"You might say that. I was able to give Mrs. O'Neill $500 to hire a lawyer and pay Una's bail if the lawyer can get it set."
He looked suitably impressed. "That's a lot of money. Where did you find it?" She set the cake down in front of him.
"In his safe."
"I was right about that then."
Men just loved being right, and Gino was no exception. "Yes, you were," she said sweetly, more than happy to acknowledge it. She sat down at the table opposite him. He started to take a bite, but stopped with the fork halfway to his mouth.
"If it was in a safe, how did you get it out?"
She continued to smile sweetly. He frowned.
You don't know how to crack a safe, do you?"
How nice that he thought she might actually be able to do that. And how nice to see his various horrified reactions to that thought. "Of course not. He'd written the combination down, and I found it."
"Where?"
"In his appointment diary. In his desk. Really, he wasn't very good at this at all."
"Good at what?"
"Never mind.
So, were you able to find out anything about Pollock?
He hesitated, as if he wanted to ask her something else, but then he sighed and said, "Not a lot about Pollock, but I found out more about the murder. Brogan's cousin was the first one in the house."
"Brogan? Mr. Malloy's friend?"
Gino grinned at that. "They aren't exactly friends."
"But he's a police detective too, same as Mr. Malloy was."
"Yes, although he's not the same as Mr. Malloy at all."
"Oh, I remember. He drinks, doesn't he?"
"All Irishmen drink. Brogan drinks a lot."
"Then I hope you waited until he was drunk to talk to him," Maeve said with a smile.
"He's always drunk, so that wasn't hard."
"And what did you find out?"
"Well, there was some kind of argument in the house. The servants were in the kitchen, and they claimed they don't know who was there or what the argument was about. They just heard shouting, and they stayed where they were, trying to pretend they didn't hear anything because it was none of their business."
"Did the Pollocks fight a lot?"
"I didn't talk to the servants myself, so I don't know. And all this is second hand, remember. Well, third hand, really."
"I just think it's funny the servants claim they don't know who was shouting. Servants know everything that goes on in their house."
"I know, which is why we need to question them ourselves. Anyway, after all the arguing, things got quiet for a while, and they thought it was safe to come out. That's when they found the Pollocks, both of them, on the parlor floor. He was all bloody, and she'd sat down with him and put his head in her lap."
Maeve tried to picture this in her mind. "Then what happened?"
"One of the maids ran out and found the beat cop, who was Brogan's cousin. He saw Una and Pollock in the parlor, then he sent for the ward detective, who decided Una did it and arrested her."
"That sure made it easy for him," Maeve said. "How was she supposed to have killed him?"
"Just like Mrs. O'Neill said, somebody hit him over the head."
"With what?"
"Brogan didn't know."
"That would make a lot of difference," Maeve said. "If it was something in the house, she might have done it, but if it wasn't..."
"I'm probably going to have to get Brogan's cousin drunk to find out more."
"Or maybe I can just ask the servants."
Gino raised his eyebrows. He had very nice eyebrows, she noticed. "When would you do that?"
"Tomorrow, when I go back to pack up all of Una's clothes. Mrs. Decker was going to send her maid to do it, but now I think I should."
"Why?"
"Because Mrs. Decker thought they should close the house and let the servants go, since there's no one to pay them."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.